On December 7, 1941, an armada of Japanese planes took off from aircraft carriers deep in the Pacific Ocean. A few hours later, they were wreaking havoc and destruction on the American Pacific Fleet at Pearl Harbor, Hawaii. American blood was shed on American soil by a foe many Americans thought to be inferior. A day later, Congress declared war on Japan and brought the United States of America into the most destructive war of the 20th century. Some of the people who were angriest with the attacks were Japanese Americans themselves.
Gray, dove gray, with red dots on the wings. I knew they were Japanese. And I felt that the world that I had known and had dreamt about and planned for had come to a shattering end.
Despite this anger, however, their loyalty was called into question, and the government they had respected reacted rashly and decided to imprison its own citizens within their country. The attack on Pearl Harbor led to a period of hysteria and irrational reactions in our nation's government, where the Constitution was ignored and thousands of loyal Americans were wrongly imprisoned. Many white people, governmental and civilian, thought that if Japan's attack against the U.S. had been successful, there must have been sabotage involved. Ise and Nisi, first and second generation Japanese Americans, were as angry, if not angrier, than other Americans. FBI inspectors came around to Japanese-American neighborhoods and searched houses for anything Japanese. In a few days, many racial slurs and caricatures appeared in newspapers and editorial cartoons. One entitled How to Spot a Jap by Milton Caniff, a popular children's cartoonist, made many racist remarks and showed a typical Japanese man as a short, frowning, shuffling, lisping subhuman. Prejudice increased. People who had knowledge of the coastline, made frequent trips to Japan, or had been part of Japanese society were arrested without a trial. Even Buddhist priests were not above suspicion. Prejudice against Japanese Americans grew and grew until Roosevelt was forced to take action. On February 19, 1942, a Nisi speaker said, "Our greatest friend is a man who is the greatest living man today, President Franklin Delano Roosevelt." That same day, the president he loved was signing a document that would send him and thousands of other loyal Americans to camps far away from their homes. The document was Executive Order 9066, which forced Japanese Americans to move into relocation centers. In one stroke of his pen, Roosevelt took away the power of Francis Biddle, the Attorney General, to deal with civilians in wartime, and gave it to the Secretary of War. He felt he had the power to issue this order as Commander-in-Chief, much as Lincoln had done with the Emancipation Proclamation in 1863. Overnight, signs appeared on street corners with the ominous heading, "To all people of Japanese ancestry." Executive Order 9066 gave the WRA, a war relocation authority, and the Army the power to prescribe war zones within the United States and move all suspicious people to them. This order was entirely against the Constitution and suspended almost all the rights Nisi had been living under their entire lives. The commander of the Army's West Coast Defense was Lieutenant General John DeWitt. While he was not the only one with prejudice against Japanese, he was the one in the best position to act on it. Disliked by his superiors and ridiculed by the FBI, his main claim to fame before the war was being a general in the Quartermaster Corps. DeWitt claimed that there was no way to tell if Japanese Americans were loyal or dangerous. His West Coast Defense issued this statement about Japanese Americans being singled out. "Because of the ties of race, the intense feelings of filiality, and the strong bonds of common tradition, culture, and customs, this population presented a tightly knit racial group. It was impossible to establish the identity of the loyal and disloyal with any degree of safety." DeWitt created 12 restricted zones that Japanese, German, or Italian Americans were not allowed to stay in or enter. Initially, these zones were mainly in Washington and Oregon, but eventually they stretched to cover all of California. The WRA encouraged alien families to move out of these areas to places farther inland. About 5,000 left. On March 27, 1942, the window of opportunity closed and all Japanese Americans who remained in the areas were sentenced to imprisonment. With what FBI Director J. Edgar Hoover called hysteria and lack of judgment, DeWitt made all Nisi citizens non-aliens and officially authorized the relocation and internment of all Japanese Americans on the West Coast. Attorney General Francis Biddle wrote, "The decisions were not made on the logic of events or on the weight of evidence, but on the racial prejudice that seemed to be influencing everyone. Japanese-American homes and businesses that had just been recovering from the Great Depression were forced to sell to white buyers who snapped up deals for a few dollars. Homes, personal property, and pets were all left behind in the rush to pack belongings into the allotted two suitcases. Yoshiko Uchida remembered, "We sold things we should have kept, and packed away foolish trifles that we should have discarded." After the war, the U.S. government estimated that the Japanese Americans left behind $200 million worth of property. The date of the evacuation was March 23, 1942. Entire neighborhoods moved silently to the staging areas. There, they boarded trains with the shutters down and armed guards patrolling the corridors. These trains would take tens of thousands of loyal Americans to 16 abandoned racetracks and fairgrounds that would serve as assembly centers while the permanent camps were being built. From these centers, they moved to the internment camps. By December 7, 1942, the anniversary of Pearl Harbor, every person on the West Coast who had ancestors that came from Japan was imprisoned in a WRA camp. One Nisi asked, "Why do all the guns point inward?" American soldiers, better suited for fighting the enemy, were used to guard loyal Americans. The soldiers, who had once stood for freedom, now acted as prison guards. Three times, Nisi brought the case of internment to the Supreme Court in the cases Yasuo v. United States, Hirabayashi v. United States, and Korematsu v. United States. All three times, the court ruled in favor of internment. The court felt that the power of the military was greater than the constitutional rights of citizens during wartime. One of the resistors, Fred Korematsu, explains why he reacted the way he did.
"I didn't think that the government would go as far as to include American citizens to be interned without a hearing. And then later on, they changed my draft card to 4C, which is enemy alien. Those days, if you're an Asian, people automatically think you don't belong in this country. You're not an American. And I thought that was wrong."
Some Nisi enlisted in the 442nd Regimental Combat Team. Authorized by Roosevelt on February 1st, 1943, it was an all-Japanese-American regiment that would later join up with the 100th Infantry Battalion, a unit made up of Hawaiian Japanese that were in the army when the war started. The regiment went to Europe and saw action in Italy and France. They were one of the best units in the army and earned 9,486 Purple Hearts, 585 Silver Stars, and one Congressional Medal of Honor, the highest military award. By the later years of the war, much of the hysteria of 1941 and 42 had died down. By June 1944, the Germans were being beaten back in Europe, and the possibilities of a Japanese attack on the West Coast were virtually non-existent. Roosevelt was recorded saying that some Japanese-American families might be able to return home. This became a reality in late 1944, when the Supreme Court case Endo v. the United States overturned the previous decisions, and the WRA became determined to close the camps, even if they had to force the internees out. Some internees would return home to find that friendly white neighbors had kept their houses intact, while others returned to shattered windows and graffiti-covered walls. In 1946, the survivors of the 442nd Regiment marched down Constitution Avenue in Washington, D.C., where President Truman congratulated them on their fight against prejudice. The government realized it had reacted rashly and has reformed its policy towards first-generation Japanese Americans and allowed them to become citizens. Several presidents have sent out formal letters of apology to Japanese Americans who were interned. In 1980, Congress appointed the Commission on Wartime Relocation and Internment of Civilians. It found that the government's actions were not necessary and went on to recommend that the veterans of the camps be reimbursed. Also during the 1980s, the three Japanese Americans who resisted during the relocation reopened their cases in an attempt to clear their names. Two of them, Gordon Hirabayashi and Fred Korematsu, were able to overturn their cases. Unfortunately, one of them, Yasuo, was unable to. In 1988, the Civil Liberties Act was passed, which gave money to everyone who had been interned. The internment of civilians in wartime is a tragic mistake that will never and should never happen again.